Hi everyone, good morning. We'll wait 1 minute or 2 minutes to see if more people are attending and then we'll start the session. Hello, everyone. Welcome to today's workshop on cloud native API management, Microsoft in Kubernetes. I hope everyone can hear me and see my screen. So let's get started with today's workshop. I am Dinusha Dissanayake. I currently work as a senior software engineer at WSO2. And I've been working with API Manager team since 2017, and I have closely worked with the API Manager product stack, including API Manager, API Manager Analytics, API Micro Gateway. And now I am more focused in the cloud native API management aspects of API Manager team. And I have helped and I have provided consultancy for a lot of customers and conduct training session to build their enterprise solutions. So in today's session, what we would cover is we will discuss about microservices architecture in brief and about the service mesh as well. And then we'll talk about how API management fit in the service mesh paradigm. Later, we'll talk about API manager, API operator for Kubernetes. Then we'll see how we can apply this API operator in an Istio service mesh. Then we'll have a look on the API management ecosystem, how you can experience a fully fledged API management experience. After that, we'll explore how we can apply API management for the APIs, for the microservices that you have. And at last, we'll be doing a demonstration on applying API management to the microservices that you have deployed in your service mesh. In this session, we mostly focus on the demonstration and we'll talk in brief about the rest of the topics. So if you have any questions, you can put it in the chat and I will answer them at the end of this session. So let's move on with our presentation. So let's talk about the microservices architecture and the service mesh. Microservices architecture enables you to deploy your application in a distributed way. It's actually quite useful for almost everyone if you have a very large system. Because that you being able to deploy these applications in a distributed manner, you can loosely couple your components and you can deploy each component individually. And if you want to do some improvements, you can do those changes or bug fixes to those components individually and frequently. Because these microservices are loosely coupled, you can scale the components that you want without affecting to the rest of the distribution system. Even though this microservices architecture enables us to it makes our lives easier, but there are some drawbacks that makes our lives hard, such as a network latency, security vulnerabilities, likewise. To address these lot of problems, the concept of service mesh was introduced. The primary objective of service mesh is to help service-to-service discovery, service-to-service communication. Service mesh helps you to help service communicate between service-to-service in a secure and a faster way. It also provides you the option or the feature to do load balancing, service discovery, authentication, traffic management, and circuit breaking like features. This is an example of a service mesh. You can see that I have in here the namespace micro is a namespace which the Istio injection is enabled. So if you deploy a service there, so I have here in this diagram, you can see that the three services have been deployed, review service, product service, and event service. Once you deploy this service, since the Istio injection is enabled, a sidecar proxy will get attached to each of these services, so that it helps to communicate between the services inside the service mesh. And here the API consumer access these microservices using the Istio ingress gateway. Now let's have a look at how API management fit in a service mesh. In this diagram, you would see the capabilities in a service mesh and as capabilities in API management platform. And you can see some of the most important API management capabilities are already there in the service mesh, such as security, rate limiting, traffic routing, and so on. But let me take a step back and explain. The primary focus of a service mesh and the API management are two different things. The primary focus of a service mesh, as I mentioned earlier, is to handle inter-service communication or east-to-west traffic. And the gateway's primary focus is to handle north-to-south traffic or the client-to-server traffic. So having only security, rate limiting, and traffic routing does not fulfill your API management capabilities. It helps, but it does not fulfill your API management capabilities. In order to have a complete API management story, you need to have these other capabilities such as developer ecosystem. So then the API creators or the API publishers would create the APIs and publish them. And the application developers who are using your APIs, there should be a place for them to explore your APIs. So they would come and explore the APIs that are available, and they would refer the documentation, they would refer the forums, comments, and SDKs. So there should be a place for those things as well. And if you want to make an income out of your API, and if you want to enable monetization and billing, what you can do is, you can use our API management capabilities to enhance these things. And if the application developers wants SDKs for their application, you should be able to download these SDKs as well. And to have a valid subscription to invoke these APIs and to apply mediation policies, you might need some simple mediation policies such as applying a header, doing a simple transformation, likewise. So So you see that even though the service mesh provides some of the API management capabilities, in order to have a fully fledged API management system for your microservices, you need a combination of the combination of both of these paradigms. Now let's have a look at what this API operator for Kubernetes is. API operator for Kubernetes is a distribution developed by WSO2 to make APIs a first-class citizen in Kubernetes ecosystem. It's very easy to deploy. What do you mean by a first-class citizen in Kubernetes ecosystem? Similar to deploying a service YAML, deployment YAML, or pod, or any other Kubernetes artifacts in the Kubernetes ecosystem, you can simply define an API definition or API YAML and deploy that in the Kubernetes system, the Kubernetes cluster, and the API operator will spin up an API gateway for you. It imposes a security, throttling, mediation monitoring for your microservices. Since there are components resides in control plane and management plane that helps us to complete the API management story, it allows you to experience full for cloud native API management system. And it has the built-in capability for deployment patterns, such as private jet mode, shared mode, sidecar mode. So the API developers do not have to worry about the deploy by creating deployment YAML or services. The API operator will take care of those things on behalf of the API publisher. They just have to mention the deployment pattern that they want in the API definition, and the API operator itself will deploy it without any additional work for the API creator. And to deploy this API in Kubernetes cluster, you need a single source of the open API definition as a single source of truth. Here you can see what you are seeing here is the operator overview. So what have we introduced with this operator? With this operator, we have introduced four Kubernetes custom resource definitions. And along with that, we have introduced four Kubernetes operators relevant to each of these custom resource definitions. So we have introduced four CRDs. One is for API CRD to handle the API definition and to deploy the API micro gateways. And the other one is target endpoint custom resource definition, which handles the backends. It's super easy. You would see in our demonstration also. So the users don't have to worry about their backends. They just have to mention what is the image that they want to use as their backend system, so that the API operator will deploy that on behalf of them and maintain the deployment. And the security CRD helps you to apply the security policies on the API that you are exposing in the Kubernetes cluster. So at the moment, we support JW token, OPAC token, and basic auth and API keys support using this API operator. So what you can do is you can create a security custom resource and apply on the Kubernetes cluster. Then in the API definition, you can refer this security, security custom resource that you want to apply on that API. If you haven't mentioned any specific security custom resources, we have a default security policy that will get applied on the API itself. So which is by default, the security mechanism is JWT, so we are using that. And the other custom resource is the rate limiting. To regulate the incoming traffic for the API gateways, we have introduced the rate limiting custom resource definition as well, where you can define the request that you want within certain time frame. You can mention these things and deploy. Similar to the security custom resource definitions, you have to refer the rate limiting policy that you want to apply on the API in the open API definition. Then what happens is once you deploy this open API definition in the Kubernetes cluster, it will refer those necessary artifacts and it will spin up a gateway according to those details. So how we provide this open API definition? The open API definition for your microservices has to be provided to a CLI tool called API-CTL. API-CTL is a tool developed by WSO2 which can communicate with the API operator for Kubernetes. So what happens is when you provide the open API definition to the API-CTL tool and ask it to create an API with this name in this micro namespace, it will create an API custom resource and deploy that on the Kubernetes cluster. Then the API operator will recognize that and it will create an API gateway runtime image and it will push that API image to a Docker registry. This Docker registry is configured at the installation phase of the API operator. We are using Google's container tool called Kaniko to build Docker images inside the Kubernetes. Once this API image creation is successful, it will deploy the relevant Kubernetes artifacts on the Kubernetes cluster, such as pods, deployments, services, and horizontal pod autoscalers. So the API creator would not have to worry about any of those things. If the so you can see that the we are providing a certain command with the open API definition. So if that particular API name, if a in that Docker registry, if that particular image exists, it will not create the API image from scratch. It will use that image and deploy the Kubernetes artifacts using that image. If you want to override that image, we have to use a flag as --override to build a new image from scratch. You will see that we are doing that in the demonstration. So now let's have a look at how we can use API operator in a service mesh. So basically, we have identified three modes. One is API operator with Istio in permissive mode. Here, the Istio is configured in the permissive mode. And you can see that the backend services are running in a namespace where the Istio injection is enabled and the sidecar is already attached to them. But we are deploying the API micro gateway in a different namespace. The Istio injection is disabled so that if an API consumer wants to talk to the, so if someone wants to apply API management for the microservices in the permissive mode, then they can use this approach so that the API consumer would talk to the API micro gateway and the micro gateway would talk to the microservice deployed in the service mesh. And the other one is API operator with Istio in mutual TLS mode. Here, the Istio is deployed in the mutual TLS mode. This is the setup is almost similar to what we discussed previously, but instead of communicating directly API gateway with the backends, here API gateway communicates with the Istio ingress gateway, and the Istio ingress gateway communicates with the backend system. There's a virtual service in Istio to route the traffic from Istio ingress gateway to the backend services. Then the other mode is the API operator with Istio in sidecar mode. Here, what we are doing is we are deploying the API micro gateway in the same namespace where we have enabled the Istio injection. With this approach, you can select only the microservices that you want to apply API management and expose that using WSO2 API gateway, and Istio ingress gateway will talk to that gateway, and the gateway will talk to the backend services. If you have microservices which do not want to apply API management, you can directly expose them using the Istio Ingress Gateway. This works with both permissive and mutual TLS scenario. So in today's demonstration, we'll focus on this and how we can apply API management and how we can get the best from the API operator to apply API management. Now let's have a look at the API management ecosystem. So up to now, we discussed about the API gateway runtime, which we deployed in the data plane. So we discussed how our backends are being deployed and how our microservices are how our API gateways are getting deployed. But in order to experience a complete API management story, this is not the only part that we have to focus. There are some other components resides in the control plane and the management plane. Here, the key manager, which resides in the control plane, is responsible for key generation to invoke the APIs, because you know, the API gateways which are deployed in the data plane are like secured. So in order to access those things, those APIs, we need to have a valid access token and valid subscription. To get that, we need to have we are using the functionality of the key manager. And then when we are invoking the API to validate the token, sometimes we have to talk to the key manager in some scenarios. So the key manager does key generation and key validation to give a API management feature. And the other component is traffic manager, which also resides in the control plane, which enables you to regulate your traffic. So so if you have a cluster of API gateways and when you want to limit the number of requests that are coming to your gateway, the traffic manager helps to regulate the traffic and limit the number of requests that are coming to your API gateways. And the components resides in a management plane, API publisher, API developer portal, and API analytics enables to have a complete API management story. Let's start with API publisher. We have discussed this previously also. So the API creators and publishers can log into the API publisher and productize their APIs. They can add, they can create APIs. They can add business details. They can add documentation. They can do a lot of things in this API publisher. They can manage the API's lifecycle, those things. And the application developers who are actually using your APIs, they would log into your developer portal and they would. Now that they have a developer portal or API marketplace, they can log into this portal and explore the APIs that are available. Then they can refer the documentation on how to use those things and what are the needed parameters, what are the headers that are needed. So they can explore these things very easily. And the API analytics. So once you enable the analytics, even though the Istio provides inter-service, the observability and the tracing related to services, the API analytics provide the idea of how the APIs are behaving, how the APIs are being used in your system. Like you can get an idea on what are the APIs that are mostly used, what are the API resources that are mostly used, and what are the APIs that are least used less. Likewise, with these information, you can get a lot of business decision that helps to improve your businesses, such as to improve the infrastructures, to identify what are the most used products, likewise. So the API analytics comes in handy to improve your business as well. So you can see that the combination of this management plane, control plane, and the data plane, these all these components helps you to experience a complete API management story. This is how the API publisher looks like. In this, in the demo, you will also see this. So we have, once we log into the API publisher, you can create the API definition by providing the resources, backends, and the subscription policies, and so on. This is how the API marketplace look like. Where this is where the end users who are developing the applications come in and explore the APIs that are available in your developer portal. It helps you to search API faster, and it helps you to explore and to have discussion, community discussion, get a feedback on the APIs as well. This is how the analytics portal looks like. So depending on the user, like for API publisher, there's a separate portal, and for API application developers who are using the developer portal, there's a separate portal, so that they each and everyone can get their own understanding of the APIs. Now we'll see how we can apply this fully the complete API management for the microservices that are deployed in the service mesh. So how we can utilize these components in control plane, management plane, to deploy API gateways in the data plane. We have identified two approaches. One is the Swagger first approach, or as known as developer first approach. And the other one is publisher first approach, or the design first approach. In the Swagger first approach, we are using a CLI tool to deploy the APIs and to push this API to the API publisher. Here we need to have a Swagger definition which is suitable for your microservices. Once you have this Swagger definition, what you can do is you are providing this Swagger definition to the API CTL tool and ask it to add this API definition as an API in the Kubernetes cluster in this particular namespace. Then it will spin up an API gateway, and it will deploy all the artifacts in Kubernetes cluster. Now the API gateway is up and running in the Kubernetes cluster. So now we need to find a way to push this API into the control plane to be available at the API publisher and the API developer portal. So for this, we are using the same tool, API CTL, and we are creating API project. You will see more in the demonstration as well. So what we are doing is we will push this API to the API publisher portal. Then the API creators or the API publishers can log into this publisher portal in the control plane, the management plane. And what they would do is they would productize this API. What do you mean by productize? Is they would add the business value to this API. They would add the necessary documentation. They would add the business details, technical details, if they want any other information. If they want to manage API lifecycle, they would do all these things. Once you productize your APIs, you can publish this API so that it would be publicly available. So once this is publicly available, the application developers who are using these APIs would log into the developer portal and explore these APIs. So they would go and see what are the information that they need. So what this API is about, and what are the information that they need, and they would subscribe this API to a application, and they would get a access token, and they would try it out in the developer portal. So you don't have to go anywhere else, or you don't have to use any client. With the help of the API developer, you can invoke the API from there itself. Then you can get an idea of what is the response look like, what are the necessary parameters. All these things can be, you can get an idea in the API developer portal. The other approach is the publisher first approach. So what we are doing here is we are creating an API in the API publisher. So as I mentioned earlier, the previous approach or the design first approach is based on a CLI tool. It's you can use that easily in a CI/CD scenario as well. This is based on a UI approach where you log into the API publisher and you would create an API from the scratch. You would add context, version, the endpoints, the subscription policies, the resources, what are the resources, what are the parameters that you need, everything you would include from the UI in the publisher. Once you do that, you have to deploy this API in the Kubernetes. In order to deploy this in Kubernetes, we have introduced a feature called private chat mode. So in this private chat mode, what we are doing is we are enabling Kubernetes. We are configuring Kubernetes clusters in the API manager, WSUIT API manager, so you can publish your APIs in the Kubernetes cluster. We have a configuration file called deployment.toml. In there, what we are doing is we'll configure the master URL and access token for the Kubernetes cluster and what is the namespace that we want to deploy these APIs to, and so on. I will explain more on this later. So once you do that and start the API management, in the environment section, you can see the environments that are available to publish this API to. Since we are going in the cloud native approach and since we want to deploy our API in Kubernetes ecosystem, we select the Kubernetes cluster that we want to deploy, and then we will publish this API, which should be done after productizing your API. Then API gateway would be created in the Kubernetes cluster in the same way that happened previously. Then the API also will be pushed to the developer portal for public access. So once we confirm that the API gateway is up and running, we can go to the API developer portal, and then we can invoke this API in the same way that we invoked the API previous way. The API invocation part is almost similar. Let's move on to our demo on applying API management to microservices in a service mesh. Here we are using using a scenario where we have certain microservices in a service mesh, and we are going to apply API management and experience the full API management story in this scenario. So this is what the demo looks like today. So first, we will deploy a microservices in a STO service mesh, and then we will apply API management to those microservices using API operating sidecar mode. Here we will use the both approaches that we discussed in previous slides. The one is a Swagger first approach, and the other one is publisher first approach. In the Swagger first approach, we will deploy the micro gateways in this operator and import the API publisher and productize the API and publish the API. And once we complete those steps, we will invoke the API. We will discover this API in the marketplace, and we will invoke this API with the valid subscription and a valid access token. For this demo, we need some of the things configured. So the first thing is we need kubectl. This is to communicate with the Kubernetes cluster. And we need a Kubernetes cluster with Kubernetes version 1.15 or above. Kubernetes cluster, we need a minimum CPU of 8 virtual CPUs and memory of 8 gigabytes. And since we are using service mesh, we need STO version 1.6.5 or above. And we need an account in Docker registry. It could be Docker Hub, AWS, or GCR. Or if you have a private Docker registry, you can use that as well. The reason for having this Docker registry is, as you can remember, the API operator creates the API gateway image. So you need to push this image to a secure location. So we need for that we need to have a Docker registry or Docker registry. And we need to install the API operator in the Istio mode, and we need to configure the API controller, the CLI tool in your machine to communicate with the API operator as well as the API manager deployment. And you need to have an API manager deployment with the private jet mode enabled. You can deploy this in the Kubernetes cluster itself, since we have resources, and or else you can use a separate VM. In today's demonstration, my API manager is running locally, but the Kubernetes cluster is running on GKE. For all these things, I hope at the end of the sessions later you would get on hold of these slides. In the later slides, I have included all the other links for these things on how to configure each of these things. So you can go through each one of these links and follow that, and you would get a clearer idea and you would get hands-on experience. So moving on to the demonstration, we'll start this with deploying the microservices first in the namespace called micro. As you can see, I have created a namespace called micro, and I have enabled Istio injection for that microservices, micro namespace. And these are my backend services, product service, inventory service, and review service. You can see I am using the target endpoint custom resource definition to deploy my backend services. You can see how simple the definition is and how easy it is to deploy your backend services. You simply have to provide the API, the back, Docker image or the image of your backend services, and you have to define the ports and other things. Then once you apply these things, it will create all the Kubernetes artifacts necessary for your backend, such as deployments, services, and it would also create the horizontal pod autoscale, so that you don't have to worry about anything about scaling your backend. So basically, you don't have to worry about your backends at all, managing backends at your org. So it would scale. You can even mention the replicas that you want here. So as the load increases, the backend will also scale up and scale down. So we'll deploy this in our Kubernetes cluster. I have already deployed the micro namespace to configure the private jet mode, so it's not creating again or configuring, but the backend services are creating in the micro namespace. So we can see how the backends are running by checking the ports running in the micro namespace. You can see that the backend services, inventory, products, and review are running in the back in the micro namespace, and you can see that there are two containers running in each port. One is the actual backend; the other one is the sidecar. Now, what we have to do is now we have to create the API project. Now we have to deploy this API. So what we have to do is, in order to expose these backends, or in order to apply API management for these backend services, we need to deploy API gateway in the Kubernetes cluster. For that, we need a staggered definition, which is compatible for your backend services. And this is the Saga definition that I'm using. Here, I have mentioned the API name and the version and the base path which we are accessing the API. And I have defined each and every resources, product resource, product ID, and I have specified the backends for each of these resources with this XWSO2 production endpoints event extension. So this XWSO2 base path and this XWSO2 production endpoints are two end extensions that are mandatory in this API definition. So I have pointed the API products, and I have pointed the review endpoint and the inventory endpoint as well. So now what we are going to do is, now we are going to create an API project using the API CTL tool. For that, I am using the API CTL init command. You don't have to worry about these commands. you will get on hold about these things in details and the learning materials. So I'm with this API CTL init command, you can provide a name for your API project and the source that you are creating the API project from. So you have a Saga definition, so you are creating an API project. So this creates a folder structure with the Saga file that you are on, that you have provided, and the metadata of that particular API, such as name and the other details, gateway environments, etc. So once you provide these details, you can use this same API project to publish your API in the Kubernetes cluster, as well as to push it to the management plane. So now what I will do is, I will deploy this gateway in the Kubernetes cluster. So as you can remember, I am providing the this is the command that you are using to apply to create the API gateway in the Kubernetes cluster. API CTL add the API, then you have to provide the API name with minus N flag, and then you have to provide the API project source with the minus F flag, and then you have to define the namespace that you want your API to be deployed. And as an additional flag, I am providing this minus minus override flag. As I mentioned you earlier, if in my Docker repository and this online store API SE image is already available, it would not create an API image from the scratch itself. It would skip that step, and it would create the Kubernetes artifacts relevant to that, but using that particular image. But here I want to build an image irrespective of this image is available in the Docker registry or not. So I'm using this override flag. So once I do that, it would create the necessary config maps and the API definition. So when you check the APIs available in the micro namespace, you can see that the online store API has been deployed 8 seconds ago. Now we'll have a look at the ports that are running in the micro namespace. You can see online store API ConocoJob is up and running. So this ConocoJob, as I mentioned earlier, is the one who is building the image. You can see the logs. This port to get a clear idea. You can see that the API image is getting created, API gateway image is getting created. So what happens actually is, this is an additional information. So here we have a toolkit called Micro Gateway Toolkit. By providing this Swagger, we are creating an API executable file, and then we burn that API executable into an API runtime, and we will create the API gateway image. So this would take a couple of seconds in a GKE environment. It would take nearly 60 seconds to complete and deploy the API. It's super easy. And now what we can do is, now we deploy this API in the Kubernetes cluster. Now we need to expose this API to the micro gateway to outside traffic. So what, how we are doing this, we are using Istio ingress gateway for these purposes. For that, I'm using a Istio, I'm going to deploy a Istio ingress gateway. Here I have enabled the TLS for this, and the steps on creating these artifacts are mentioned in the documentation, so I'm not going to details on these instructions. The important thing here that you have to notice is we are going to expose this API to the outside consumers using this host internal.wso2.com. So the API consumers will use this host to access the APIs which are deployed, which are exposed using this ingress gateway. So I'm going to deploy this gateway in the Kubernetes cluster. I think I have already deployed that. So as you can see, we exposed that using the internal.wso2.com hostname. So in order to locally route the traffic, I have to map the ingress gateway's external IP with this hostname. So for that, we need to get the ingress gateway's external IP. So you have to map this IP in the etc host entry. I have already done that. You can see I've already done that. So now what we are going to do is, now we have to push this image, now we have to push this API into the API publisher. For that, we'll verify our API gateway creation in the micro namespace. As you can see, the Kaniko job is now completed, and the API gateway related to that is up and running, and it also has two contents in that particular pod. One is the actual API gateway, and the other one is the sidecar proxy. So now you have your API gateway in the data plane. Now we are going to push this API into the API management plane components. For this, what we are going to do is, we are going to do that using the API CTL tool. So how the API CTL tool recognize the environment? So first we have to add the environment using the add environment command by pointing certain endpoints of that particular environment. Let's say you have multiple environments, so you can choose the if you have dev environment, test environment, QA environment, you can have different host names for each of these environments. So you can provide those details and add the environments to the API CTL tool. So here my API manager system is running in localhost 9443. So I am providing the API endpoints and the token endpoints so that and I am adding it as the dev environment. So this is the command apictl add environment minus e dev command. So I successfully added the environment. So it's the API manager that I'm running locally. So you can see I have previously created the sample API. It's already there, but with the API that we now created, this online store API, it is not available here yet. So what I'm going to do is, I'm going to import this API into the API publisher. So here, this is the command what we have to use. Here I am using API CTL import API. With the minus F, you have to provide the API project source that we are importing this API. And then you have to define the API environment that we are, which is the API environment that we are importing this API to. For this, you need to log in as an admin. So I'm logging as an admin. I'm using the default credentials. So I can see that my API is successfully imported here. you refresh that, you will see now your online story API has been created and it's in the created state. It's not yet published, which means it's not publicly available. So now we want our this API to expose in a developer portal, but at the same time, we want to let the developers know what are the accessible URLs for these APIs. So basically, we have to provide the hostname of the Ingress gateway that we have deployed in the Kubernetes cluster. How we can do that? So how we are going to do that is we have an admin portal which is running in the localhost 9443 admin. So we are logging into that, and there's a section called gateway. Here we add that hostname as a gateway label. So I'm adding this as internal gateway, and in the hostname as well. Now I successfully added my environment. Once you add this environment, when you go to the API management, as I mentioned earlier, you can see a lot of options in the publisher portal. You can see the overview and see what are the resources available, and you can do the runtime configuration if you want to add some mediation process and so on, and the API resources. And this environment section is the place where we deploy, where we select the environments that we want our APIs to be deployed. We have already deployed our API in the Kubernetes cluster. So this production sandbox is the default API environment that we are deploying the API. But in our scenario, since we want our APIs to be deployed in Kubernetes cluster and not in the default environment, we have to untick this option. We have already deployed the API in the Kubernetes runtime. So now we only need to expose the accessible details for the external consumer. So how we are providing that is by attaching the relevant gateway labels. So if you have a different hostname with the, if you have provided a different hostname for the Ingress gateway, you can create a different label by logging into admin portal, and you can select that here. So I'm selecting here and I am saving the changes. So if I want to add any business information, let's say that if I want to add the business owner details and the technical owner details, so I'll just include my names. And I will save these details. Now what I'm going to do is, in order to manage the API lifecycle of this API, you can log into the lifecycle, you can go to the lifecycle tab and you can publish this API. Once you publish this API, you can see that the lifecycle state is updated successfully and the online store API is published successfully. So what you can do is you can go to the API developer portal. This is the developer portal that the application developers would visit and explore the APIs that are available in your system. So you can see the online store API is already there in the system. So now what I'm going to do is, so I am already logged in as the admin. I'm going to check this API. So here I can see the API tryout console. And here I can see the API endpoints details which are available. And I can see the gateway details or the accessible URLs for this API as well. So in order to access this is, I told you, this is by default auth required. So in order to access these things, I need to have a valid access token. So to do that, I need to create an application. I'm adding a new application. API days. And I'm I'm defining how many times I can access this API using this application. For this demo, I'm using unlimited. You can include the description if you like. Now I created the application. So now I want to subscribe what are the APIs that I want to access using this application. So I'm going to the subscription section and I'm going to go to add subscription APIs. Here I want to expose this API. So I am subscribing this API with the unlimited tier. Now that I created subscribe this API, I am going to generate client key and client secret for this API and get a valid access token. Once you generate the keys, you will get an access token. You can copy this. Then what you can do is you can navigate to the online store API. And you can go to the tryout console. And here you can see that the API DS application I have created is there, and I'm invoking the API in the internal gateway. The server here also has mentioned. So what I'm going to do is I'm going to paste that access token here. You can paste the access token here, or after generating the keys, you can get a test key to test it in the Socket console here as well. So what I'm going to do is I'm going to try this endpoint. You can see that I'm getting a successful response from the backend. We will try some other endpoint and also see. We'll just use one of the IDs, 501. Now you can see how easy it is for API developers, the API creators to experience a complete API management story having these components, all of these components. Now these are getting successfully, these are giving successful responses, which means the server-first approach is successful. So we invoke the API as well. So now what we are going to do is, since we covered the server-first approach, now we are moving to design-first approach or the publisher-first approach. Here, what I'm going to do is I'm going to the publisher portal, and I have mentioned earlier, if you have not there for that part, so we need to enable private chain mode to deploy APIs in Kubernetes cluster. How you can do this is I'll quickly go through that. So this is the sample configuration that you can use. So here, under the container management cluster config, you have to define the type of the cluster. So my type is Kubernetes, and then you can define the names. These are the names that you want, and you can define the default, the number of replicas that you want your APIs to have, depending on the load. You can say it's 1 or 2 or as you want. Then you can define the accessible URL and the master URL and the access token in order to have permission for API manager to deploy APIs in Kubernetes cluster. And then you have to provide the namespace that you would want to deploy your APIs to. So once you configure these things, you can start the server. Then the API manager would list the environment, this Kubernetes environment, under the environment tab. So here what I'm going to do is, assume I don't have a Swagger definition already. What I'm going to do is I'm going to create an API from the scratch. So here I'm using the product endpoint. If you're using the publisher first approaches, you can only use a single endpoint at the moment. So I'm going to expose the product endpoint in service mesh and apply the API management to that microservices using the publisher first approach. So I am making this as product API. The context I am saying is product API, and I am saying version 1.0. So the endpoint is HTTP products, and you can add the business plan to allow the subscription at various levels for the consumers. So I'm just unlimited cancel. So I'm creating this API. Now that I created the API, I need to add the API resources for this API. So my, as you can remember in the Sagar definition, I had two endpoints for my products microservice. One is products, and the other one is products product ID. So I'm going to create these two resources here. And I'm going to add another one. Products ID. And I don't want these wildcard options, so I'm removing those things. So now what I'm going to do is I'm going to save this, so that the changes are being reflected here. Okay, once you do that, you can add the you can productize this API in the other ways as well. You can similar to that, you can add the business information here, or even else you can add a new documentation here on how to use APIs. I'll add a sample documentation. I can add a documentation, and I can add a content and a content in the way that I want. So I'm updating the content. You can see that to have the fine grain access control, you can create scopes and everything. So now what I have to do is I have to go to the environment section, and I have to select the environment that I want my API to be published. So as previously, I am unticking this environment, the default gateway, because I don't want my API to be deployed in the default gateway. I want my API to be deployed in the Kubernetes cluster. So in this here, you can see it's deployed in the Kubernetes. The details are listed in the Kubernetes cluster with the namespace, master URL, and the accessible URL. So once you have this, you have to save the changes. Once you change these things, you can go to the lifecycle tab as previously to manage the API lifecycle. Then what you can do is you can publish the API. Now we can see the product API is updated successfully. So if we go to the micro namespace and check the APIs that are that have deployed, you should be able to see the product API is deployed in 17 seconds ago. So if you check the ports that are getting deployed in the micro namespace, you can see a ConocoPhillips relevant to the product API is also running, which means this API gateway is being built in the Kubernetes cluster. This will, as in the same way, this will take like 60 seconds to complete the process. Yeah, it's taking time. Now you can see that the API runtime is getting pulled, and the API executable is being burned to the API gateway. Okay, now the API gateway is created. We can check the ports. Now you can see that the product's API gateway is initializing. Now you can see it's now you can see the product API is up and running. So what you can do now is you can go to the developer portal. You can go to your marketplace, and you can see the product's API is also available. So since we had the documentation, you can go to the documentation and see if it's there. You can see we included the how-to guide as the documentation, and it's there. So the application developers who are coming to the dev portal can actually see on how to use this API and all these features. This is really helpful to experience a complete API management story. So once you have, so we have successfully deployed the API. So what we can do is similar to that, we are going to invoke this API as well. So I'm using the same application. So I'm going to subscribe the API. I'm subscribing both of these APIs. And then what I'm going to do is I'm going to the API section, and I'm going to the relevant API that I want to invoke. Now I'm going to the try out console. Here I am obtaining since I have already created the application and subscribed, and I'm getting a test key just to check these API endpoints using this console. So I'm going to the product endpoint, try it out. You can see that it's also getting successfully invoked. Yes. Now the advantage of having this is, so as I mentioned in my previous slides, you can manage your API's lifecycle very conveniently using this API publisher, which resides in the management plane. Let's say that you want to update the API. So what you can do is, instead of going through updating a server on its own and redeploying that using API CTL, what you can do is, let's say I want to remove one of the resources that are there. I don't want people to get details for each and every product. So I'm deleting this resource and I'm saving it. Now I only have one resource for the product API. Then what I'm going to do is I'm going to the lifecycle section, and I'm going to redeploy it. So now let's see what's happened in the Kubernetes cluster. Now if you go to the Kubernetes cluster and if you check the pods that are running in the micro namespace, you can see a new HoneyPWD is getting created. But also the previous product API is also still running. So what does this tell us? So this means there's a ConocoJob is up and running for the new and updated API definition, but it is not completed yet. Until that, we are serving the request using the previous gateway. So what happens is, once this ConocoJob is completed, it will spin up a new API gateway for the updated API definition. Then it will terminate the previously or outdated API gateway. This is happening using the Kubernetes rolling update, so you have a minimum downtime of your API gateway. So this is actually a very cool feature, so that the users Actually, what we have done here is, in a cloud native environment, we have provided the full API management capabilities, and we have enhanced the user experience so that you have minimum work and you can solely focus on your API or business logic. So let's see. So now you can see now the product's Kaniko job is completed, and the new API is initializing. So you can see once this pod is initialized, the previous API, the product's API 58F, is terminated. So if we go to the API publisher portal, we can go to the products API tryout section. Now we can only see the products import. So if you get an access token, we can access the API. We are getting a successful response. So what else is there in this API operator, in this cloud native API management experience? What you can see here is, in a previous slide, I told you that it helps us in almost every aspect of taking care of the deployment. The other useful thing is the horizontal pod autoscalers are deployed for each and every service. As you can see, for the backend as well as for the gateways, we are deploying horizontal pod autoscalers. Let's say that you are so we can configure these threshold values in a configuration file. I also mentioned that. So what the users can actually do is, so you can see that we have pre-configured the target the value. If the CPU utilization exceeds 50%, you can scale up the container. We have also have the facility to scale up and scale down based on a custom metrics. Let's say that you want to scale your API gateway based on the number of requests coming to the API gateway. You can do that too. We have separate documentations for that as well. So this API operator takes care of everything on behalf of your. So let me quickly show you how you can configure these values as well. This is the config map that is responsible for that. So you can see CPU target and the request memory target and the limit. So these information, like these details, can be changed according to your needs. And this is how we deploy the API operator in the operator. Istio mode. So once you downloaded the distribution, you can open this controller configurator, or you can if you have already installed the API operator, what you can do is you can edit this controller config mapping the WSO2 systems and the operator mode property. So basically that's it from the demo perspective. And I think these are the learning materials. You can see I have mentioned almost everything that you would need. So I have even mentioned how to install Kubernetes client, kubectl, and how to configure API CTL tool, and how to install API operator and deploy API manager in Kubernetes. You can very easily do that. We have artifacts to deploy Kubernetes. Like we have ready-made artifacts. You can use those things. And here the API operator with Istio, the scenario that we discussed here today, we have a separate guide for that as well. So I have put down the GitHub link for that as well. And if you want to deploy your API managed in private chat mode, how you can configure these things and how you can create a service account, how you get the access token for that account, all these things I have mentioned here. So that's it. And if you have any questions, I think you can ask. And yeah, if you have any questions, we can ask. If you like to get to know about this API operator and its capabilities, you can visit us on our booth and get an assistant on that. We are more than happy to help you on that as well. And also, if you can join us with our Slack channel or mailing list for more information as well. So if we don't have any questions, I think it's okay to wrap up the session. So thank you very much for everyone who joined the workshop. I hope you might have experienced the capabilities of API operator and you have get an idea how it would help you to improve the your business solutions. Okay, thank you.